about if I give you a question and you can give me a question? How's that sound?
Okay, that sounds good.
Okay, so I guess my first question will be based on your book. I've read through your book and not in detail. I mean, it's highly technical, but the one called The Cell's Design, How Chemistry Reveals the Creator's Artistry. Now, I guess here's an overall question I have for you on that book. I would just say it's a big God of the Gaps kind of argument. And so maybe we could have a discussion on that. Why is that not God of the Gaps?
Yeah, you know, that's a really good question. And, you know, I would actually agree with the point that you're making, and that is God of the Gap arguments are really not the way any Christian apologist should try to use science to argue for the necessity of a creator. Just because we can't explain something doesn't mean it's legitimate to insert God. So I think we would agree on that point. And so what I try to do in The Cell's Design is not really argue that evolution can't explain the features of the cell's chemistry, but rather what I try to do is construct a positive argument saying that the features that we see that characterize the cell's chemistry are identical to the features that we would recognize as evidence for the work of a human designer in a system or an object produced by a human inventor or a human creator. And so by analogy, if certain features reflect the work of a mind in human designs, and we see those same features in the cell, then that presents positive evidence that the cell's chemistry is the work of a designer. It doesn't necessarily exclude other explanations, but at least it's saying that these features can positively be understood as the work of a creator. So I would argue that it's, in effect, a form of pattern recognition, which I utilized all the time as a chemist when I worked in research and development in industry. I was involved in using pattern recognition all the time. And so that's what I was attempting to do in the cell design. Whether I was successful or not, of course, is another question, but that was the attempt.
Well, let me give you an example. You know, let's say we can rewind the tape and we can see primitive man. Let's say in the evolutionary viewpoint, I believe that, you know, humans came from other animals. And so at one point, you know, they had a very rudimentary language and not too bright compared to how we are now. And imagine one caveman says to another, you know, we know that when there's a herd of elephants or buffalo coming by here, the ground shakes. We know somebody caused that. And so when there's an earthquake, obviously somebody caused that because there's a pattern. You know, we see this, we know what causes this. And so obviously something really large caused that. And what could be so large? It must be something like a god. But obviously we know that earthquakes are caused by plate tectonics now, and they had no clue about that. So would that be a similar analogy now that somebody might say, well, you say you see some kind of elements of design as a pattern, but it's just like a caveman saying, hey, we know about the ground moving, and obviously somebody made it move, when in fact we now know nobody makes the ground move, it's just plate tectonics.
Yeah, you know, that's interesting. And, you know, I think where the difference would lie would be that, in a sense, that conclusion of design is birthed out of ignorance, and so that really would be a God of the Gaps type of conclusion. On the other hand, I would argue that the features that I'm arguing reflect the work of a mind in biochemical systems are based on an increasing understanding of how these systems are structured and how they function. And, you know, there are some instances, for example, like let's say with regard to the genetic code, where you can really make a strong case that chemical evolution is simply not sufficient to account for the extreme optimization that you see in the genetic code.
So maybe we can just talk about that then. I mean, I was going to ask you, what would be an example of something to illustrate? So do you think that's the best example that you have so we can talk about one of these examples?
Yes. If I had to choose an example for design, that would be the most powerful. I would say it's the genetic code.
So now why, can you just real briefly say why you think the genetic code cannot arise naturally?
Sure. Well, I mean, First of all, the positive argument for design would be, and I'll go real quickly here, is that the fact that the code is in effect, basically a code. We, from our common experience, we know that codes come from minds, and the heart of biochemistry is, in effect, the genetic code. It defines biochemistry itself, and it turns out that the code is exquisitely optimized to withstand errors that would result from substitution mutations. And in fact, this has actually been quantified by researchers over the span of several years. The work was culminated in the early 2000s, but they published a series of papers showing the extreme optimization of the genetic code. And there was a famous paper written by Francis Crick called On the Origin of the Genetic Code, where he argued that the genetic code could not be a frozen accident because once the code was in place, any kind of change to the code would be catastrophic and lethal to life. And so he argued the code had to be a frozen accident, that the code was not capable of evolving. But on the other hand, you have now this discovery of extreme optimization, which indicates that from an evolutionary perspective, there had to be sufficient evolution of the code, significant evolution of the code, in order to achieve that optimization. And so you wind up with this essentially competing set of ideas that essentially cancel each other out. And then on top of that, you have what I believe to be powerful fingerprints for design, encoded information, plus the extreme optimization of the code.
Well, let me kind of go on to a related thing, because the DNA code is actually one reason why, as a Christian, I accepted evolution. And I'm sure you're familiar with Dennis Venema's, he's a scientist who's an evangelical Christian, and he gave the evidences for evolution, and we talked about that on a previous time.
Yes, I remember.
So, you know, for example, when you compare the code across species, and, you know, and he gives the example for, I believe it was for insulin, the gene, you can see, okay, we know that there's a gene is made up of a series of amino acids, and every amino acid is called for by a codon, a three nucleotide sequence. And it turns out that there's more than one nucleotide sequence that could code for a certain gene. So for in other words, there's no such thing as a perfect gene or a perfect code, because there are so many different alternates you can use. And it turns out when you compare across species, we can see how the same code is used and sometimes see some of the bits changing. So, you know, when I saw that, I mean, to me, that looked like it was obvious descent. And so I don't understand why you don't see that as obvious descent. You know, since there are so many different codons that could have been, so many sequences that could have been used, but they all use very similar ones.
Yeah, right. You know, that's, I would agree, that type of argument in terms of making a case for common descent is actually a very powerful argument. You know, but what's going on here with, whether it's that particular argument that you're discussing in terms of codon usage within a gene, let's say, or whether it is shared pseudogenes, shared endogenous retroviruses, you know, the list can go on and on. Fundamentally, what's being argued here is that you have these shared DNA sequence patterns, or you have shared structures within the genome that reflect, again, common ancestry or common descent. And the argument is, well, these features must have arisen in a common ancestor, and as the two lineages diverge, those particular features are retained within the genome. Their fingerprint is retained within the genome. Now, in order to fundamentally, though, interpret that as evidence for common descent, there are two major assumptions that you're making. One is that those structural features or those sequence patterns are not functional, because if they are functional, you could argue that those represent a design feature, a common design element.
But Fazale, let me interrupt you for a little bit. I mean, that's a good I mean discussion to have on pseudogenes. You're starting to go down about pseudogenes, but let's talk about specifically, as I mentioned earlier, that there are alternate codon sequences to get an amino acid, and
right.
And there are so many different possibilities to create a gene. There's no such thing as like this is the perfect insulin gene, because there's alternate codings. There is no preference. But it turns out that all these animals, you can see a sequence of how they're related. So why, I don't understand how, I know you know that, so I don't understand why you don't draw the obvious conclusion that these are, that there's descent there.
Yeah, well, in a sense, that argument is, that Dennis Venema is presenting is somewhat simplified. And you're right, and he's right, that you can have a large number of possible codons that could be used to represent a particular gene, and they would produce the equivalent protein in terms of the protein's amino acid sequence. But some things that are being discovered are that all codons are not equivalent in terms of the type of protein they ultimately produce. In other words, the precise codon that are used to specify a amino acid sequence can actually influence the rate of protein synthesis at the ribosome. This process is called translation, and it can either speed it up or slow it down. And as it either speeds up or slows down, it actually alters the way the protein folds off the ribosome. And so you can have the same amino acid sequence actually generating proteins with two different three-dimensional structures and consequently two different functional capabilities.
Wait a second, though. Wouldn't the structure have to be the amino acids are the same amino acids regardless of how they're coded? Because once they're you have alternate codons that can pull out an amino acid. So once you get the amino acid, it's going to fold exactly the same regardless of what the codons were.
Well, it exactly. In an ideal sense, if you're thinking about it from a thermodynamic standpoint, the minimum energy structure is good for that amino acid sequence when it folds into three-dimensional space is going to be the same, but you're looking at a kinetic effect. In other words, as the protein is coming off the ribosome, depending on the rate of translation, as the protein begins to explore different folding patterns, different folding folded structures, it's going to go through localized minima and maxima, but that kinetic effect is actually going to trap it into certain folding patterns based on the rate of translation. And so it's a kinetic effect, not a thermodynamic effect, mm-hmm. And it's actually producing proteins with alternate folding. And, you know, I don't have references to some of the papers that have discovered this, but I did write about it on our website at reasons.org, and so those articles that I wrote describing that work give reference to the original literature, so you know, people can check up on that if they'd like. But I think that the point I'm making is that it's not completely true that the types of codons used in a gene are necessarily equivalent, even though they may specify the same amino acid sequence. And so I think the argument that Venema is making on the surface is a very powerful argument, but it's a simplified argument that doesn't take into account
all
that we know about biochemistry.
Okay, well, let me ask you it this way then, just to drill down a little bit more. So we know when you look at the lookup table, there's a codon sequence that will pull out an amino acid. So sometimes you have two options. Sometimes, what's the most you have, like three or four options maybe for one amino acid?
I think that there may be some amino acids that have up to six codons that specify them.
Okay, so yeah. So let's say you have six different patterns that can pull out an amino acid. Now, are you saying that, for example, there's only one of those that would actually work? Or could you say maybe there's even two out of those six that might work, or even maybe three out of the six? Are you saying it has to be one out of six that would work?
No, I think, all six of them would code that same amino acid. But because those codons have different, you know, nucleotide sequences, they're coding triplets,
yeah,
that when they're being read at the ribosome through the process of translation, the processivity of the messenger RNA through the ribosome will increase or decrease depending on the particular codon.
Yeah, so I understand what you said there. So are you saying the bottom line is that then, in order to really work, because of what you're saying, are you saying that only one of those alternatives would actually work, or how many different alternatives would there be?
No, I see what you're saying. No,
yeah.
they all would work.
No, but they wouldn't work because you just said it wouldn't fold correctly.
Well, it would. Yeah, I may have misspoke. It would fold in alternate ways, and those two alternate folding structures would actually produce proteins that would have different functional attributes. And so depending upon the particular set of codons used, the same amino acid sequence can actually yield multiple functional proteins that have different three-dimensional shapes.
Well, let me rephrase it like this way in a thought experiment. Suppose I'm a mad scientist and I have high technology tools, and I take the human DNA code, and I take that codon pattern, which all humans pretty much share, and I just change one of the bits. Do you think, and so now it's an alternate coding, do you think if I chose another bit that the humans would be all messed up, or do you think you would still get a human in the same exact shape and everything?
Yeah, I think it could be you'd get either a human, you know, without much effect, or there very well could be a significant consequence. This is, in a sense, something that biochemists at this point don't really know the full range of how prominent this phenomena is, or how broad-reaching the implications of it are. In other words, this is something that is just being discovered that I think raises questions about whether or not codon usage and shared codon usage actually represents as powerful a case for common descent is being advocated by Dennis Benema and other people who would make that argument.
Well, here's the deal. Like, for example, if you could change that bit, and let's say you really did have two choices or maybe three choices, that is saying that, you know, they are true alternatives because they basically have the same end product. If that were true, then I think it seems like this is an argument for dissent, because what you see is that this is what happens, is that we do share this code and we don't see these alternatives. And so then you would say, well, if there really are alternatives but God didn't use them, you might say, well, God is just reusing a good design. But on the other hand, it looks like he's purposely, if things did not evolve, it looks like he's purposely trying to deceive us, because you can see the footprints as if things did evolve. So.
Yeah, I see your point. And, you know, I think you would argue that God is purposely trying to deceive us if indeed the use of different codons really had no impact on protein structure in terms of its three-dimensional structure, not its primary sequence. And so I think you would be correct if indeed these discoveries had been made, but the fact that these discoveries have been made suggests to me that you could truly understand this as being the work of a creator who isn't trying to deceive, but as we have more information, we begin to see, wow, this is a really efficient way of creating variability within biological systems by simply doing very minor alterations in the genome. You know, and this goes back to the point that I was making earlier, is that when you interpret shared features as evidence for common descent, you are making an assumption that those shared features are not functional.
Well, yeah, let's not go there, because that's a different argument, and that would take more time. I just wanted to talk about this one for now, about the codon coding, and then maybe mix it up a little bit. Do you have a good question for me, and then just to mix up the program a little bit?
Yeah, sure. I think it goes back to a point we kind of began discussing, And that would be related to this whole idea of methodological naturalism. Because my question would be, do you believe that by adhering to a strong form of methodological naturalism, that is, in a sense, restricting the capacity of science to discover the truth? And is it possible that what we perceive as being really powerful evidence for common descent is actually evidence that seems to be powerful because there's not really a legitimate alternative that's being offered, and that is essentially not being allowed because of the philosophical undergirding of science?
Well, I guess I'm not sure what you mean by limiting science, because it sounds like if you thought science was not limited, then what you would like to do is, it sounds like what you're asking for is to put God in the equations. You want to have a scientific thesis that says God did a miracle? Is that what you're advocating?
I would like that to be allowed.
But how can you test it?
Well, I think there's a lot of ways to test whether or not a creator was involved.
Well, see, that's one of the arguments against intelligent design is that, you know, you would say, well, we know what the patterns are, and therefore, if there was a mind that did it, they would do the same patterns. But one of the arguments is that, well, really what we know is we know what humans do for design, but we don't know what, if there's some kind of disembodied spirit that's a god, we don't really know what he would do. I guess you're assuming that he would think like we think as a mind, but we don't have...
Yeah, you know, that's... That's a very good point that you're bringing up, and in fact, I address that in the cell's design, where in effect I make that very same point, is that we do have one example of how designers operate, and that would be human beings. That's an unequivocal example.
Right. So that would tell us whether human beings design something or not, but. So
right.
I guess it's hard to speak for God when nobody knows anything about God for sure. I mean, everybody has their own ideas. Some people think there's many gods, one God, no God. You know.
Exactly. I agree with that point. And what I do in the cell's design is basically say, if we take the idea that is taught in the Judeo-Christian scriptures that human beings are made in God's image, then what we could argue is that if it's the God described in the Bible, then we would expect that what human beings do is, in effect, a mirror or a mimic of what that creator does. And so,
okay.
In a sense, it doesn't really address that concern from a non-biased perspective, but rather it's basically saying if we argue that the creator is specifically the God described in Scripture, and we take into account this idea human beings are made in God's image, then we could argue that what human beings do would be a reflection of the creator described in the Bible. But that's, in a sense, what limits that particular approach that we take in the cell design.
Mm-hmm.
But in a broad sense, you know, science does have the capability, does have the tools in the toolkit to detect intelligent activity. That's, for example, the whole point of SETI is to be able to distinguish between signals that are emanating from intelligent agents versus signals that are emanating from some kind of natural phenomena within the universe.
Well, okay, well, let me get back to your question. Do I think science is too limited if we don't consider God? You know, I guess part of me feels like, well, you know what, if you really think that there's evidence for that, I kind of appreciate the work of ID people trying to establish that. On the other hand, I can see how this ID is a sign stopper. For example, if you are really convinced that God created humans by an act of a miracle and not through evolution, then it would be foolishness for you to study scientifically how humans could have evolved. So in other words, it's a sign stopper, because why would you try to investigate something that you know God did? Now, for example, you know, it reminds me, you know, the old story about Laplace. I think he came to Napoleon and said, here's my idea about how the stars and the planets move. And so Napoleon says, well, where's God in this? And he goes, well, I have no need for that hypothesis. So, I mean, if people would have thought, oh, well, God is the one moving the stars around and everything, nobody would have went further to find out really what, you know, all these ideas about gravity and general relativity and all this stuff. So, I mean, to me, I see the obvious science stopper there. We continually thought, well, this is a miracle. Oh, I guess not. Oh, this is a miracle. Oh, I guess not. So it's always just one after another. That's the history of breakthroughs in science.
Yeah, you know, that's a common objection to intelligent design, is that it would be a science stopper. And I don't really see it that way. To me, I think what it does, let's say if you evoke a design hypothesis, it just, I think, produces a different set of questions or may emphasize certain questions at the expense of other questions. So, for example, you know, if you think that God is responsible for bringing life into existence, there still would be very powerful motivation for studying biochemical systems just simply to see, you know, what exactly did the Creator do, to think the Creator's thoughts after him. But then if the Creator is actually generating designs in nature, there would be a lot of motivation to understand those designs for practical reasons, because that then gives us a blueprint or a pattern to develop our own designs, if you will, and to create technologies with those designs that are present in nature. And it's interesting that there's a whole area of engineering known as biomimetics, where engineers are actually doing that very thing. And I think that that practice fits more naturally within a design framework as opposed to an evolutionary framework where you're arguing evolution creates the designs in nature, but those designs very well could be suboptimal. So I'm not completely convinced the science stopper argument is completely valid.
Well, it's like this. Suppose the scientific establishment believed, as you did, that humans were made as a miracle and not evolved from other animals. That means, you know, if that was the thrust of the whole scientific community, then when somebody said, hey, I want to study evolution, and I think I have some tests here to figure out what happened here, they would look at them and say, you're wasting your time. Why would you waste your time on something like that?
Yeah, well, you know, in a sense, that's what the scientific community has said about design, is that, of course, we accept the idea that evolution explains life's origin and life's history, so why would you want to explore this idea that is more reminiscent of Paley than Darwin, because we've already eliminated design as a possible explanation. Yet, on the other hand, the evolutionary paradigm has not been very successful at all. In fact, it's been arguably an abysmal failure when it comes to trying to account for the origin of life through chemical evolution. I mean, in a sense, there's been 60, 70 years of intense work on this problem, and there's really been no genuine progress made since Stanley Miller's day.
This is one difference I got from being, when I was a Christian, I think being a Christian is kind of easier to fall for a God of the gaps argument, because I think the mentality goes like this, that, you know, we are really smart, and if we don't understand something, then obviously something smarter than us made it, and that'd be like God. But there's, the more I learned about science, I think the more humble I've got, and I, for one thing, I've learned there's so much out there that I don't know, so I really had to dig deep. And for another thing, I've learned that there's a lot that science doesn't know. For example, you know, what dark energy and dark matter is. That's why they call it dark, because they don't know. So I think part of the problem is thinking that we are so smart that if we don't know it, obviously something smarter made it. I mean, it's kind of like, again, look at the cavemen. They're sitting around arguing about who made earthquakes. Well, they're ignorant. They don't know what they're talking about. And in the same way, you can look at us as humans and saying, yeah, of course we don't know how life evolved. Why is it? Because we're still ignorant. We know how to deal in this four-dimensional world, you know, space, the length, width, height of space, and then also time. But, you know, in string theory, they posit maybe there's 10 dimensions. How could we, you know, of course we don't know this stuff, because we're like as dumb as cavemen, you know? So I wouldn't be surprised. I don't think it's a surprise that we don't know things. I wouldn't say it was an abysmal failure. I'd say we're trying to get closer and closer as time goes on. you see the difference about looking at it as a failure versus trying to come up to speed?
Yeah, but let me address that point specifically with regard to the origin of life question. I would not, I want to make sure, even though I'm saying I think origin of life research has been an abysmal failure, it doesn't mean that I don't have the utmost respect for the scientists that are involved in that work. We're looking at this problem from an evolutionary perspective. In fact, I would argue that these scientists have been successful in identifying that principle. There are chemical reactions and physical processes that can generate life's building blocks, that can assemble those building blocks into functional molecules, and they've worked out the mechanisms for how these processes work. But where they have failed is showing that that chemistry can translate from a laboratory setting where they've discovered the chemistry to the conditions of the early Earth. And you can actually show through rigorous experimentation that as soon as you move from conditions that are pristine laboratory conditions to the conditions that most certainly would have existed on the early Earth, the chemistry no longer is productive. In fact, it's frustrated, and in some cases, it's not even possible on the early Earth. And so what they've shown is that the chemistry works in laboratory settings when you are evoking intelligent agents to oversee the chemistry, but as soon as you go to uncontrolled situations, again, the chemistry doesn't work. Mm-hmm. And in fact, this is a conclusion that's not my conclusion, but rather a conclusion that's been drawn by origin of life researchers themselves. And I can give you statements made by a number of prominent scientists that are involved in the origin of life where they basically make the statement to the effect that it, for all intents and purposes, the hand of researchers represents the hand of God, and that, again, we've not made any kind of real progress because of this problem of translating it to the conditions of the early Earth. So this is a situation where I believe that you could argue that maybe insisting on the evolutionary paradigm is actually the science stopper, not exploring the possibility that maybe a designer was involved in some way.
Okay. How about let's in order to try to mix it up a little bit more, what I'd like to see if we can do maybe two more topics. I'll have a question or topic for you, and then you can have one for me, and spend about 4 minutes on each one of these.
Sure.
Because we only have about 12 minutes or less, actually about 8 minutes or so.